JFT, just fair and direct.
Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week March the 9th until March the 13th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our webinar. Okay, this week saw a very ugly start with Asian stock and global share futures tumbling as following the inability of the OPEC Plus group to agree on new production cuts, Saudi Arabia decided to hike crude production and to cut its official selling price. Oil prices themselves, Brent and WTI, are now trading nearly 30% down from their Friday closings. Now, fears with regards to the coronavirus's economic impact heightened, also weighing on investors' morale and thereby the stock markets. As for this week's events, the main one will be the ECB monetary policy decision, and it will be interesting to see whether the ECB will follow the footsteps of the RBA, the FOMC, and the Bank of Canada in cutting rates. Now let's start with Monday. Monday appears to be a relatively light day in terms of economic releases. We only get second-tier indicators. During the European morning, we have Germany's industrial production, current account and trade data for January. Industrial production is forecast to have rebounded 1.7% month over month after tumbling 3.5% in December, while the nation's current account surplus is forecast to have narrowed to 20.1 billion euros from 29.4 billion euros. The trade surplus is also anticipated to have narrowed to 15.4 billion from 19.2 billion. Now, later in the day, both Canada's housing starts and building permits for February and January, respectively, are expected to have slowed. Having said all that, though, the week did not start as quietly as the calendar suggests. Asian stock markets and global share futures tumbled at the opening as following the breakdown of a new deal between major OPEC and non-OPEC oil producers, Saudi Arabia decided to hike its crude production and to cut its official selling price. The decision came after Russia denied joining steep production cuts proposed by the OPEC in order to stabilize the energy market hit by the economic effects of the coronavirus. Now, among the G10 currencies, the oil-related NOK and the Canadian dollar were found to be the main losers this morning, followed by the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi. The main gainers were the safe havens yen, the Swiss franc, followed by the euro. As for oil prices themselves, Brent and WTI are now trading 26.42 and 27.80 down from their Friday closings. You can see the huge negative gaps here and the strong tumble following the developments surrounding the OPEC and non-OPEC producers meeting. Now, speaking about the virus, although cases slowed somewhat on Sunday, you can see here that we are back below zero, deaths accelerated sharply. You can see how the strong acceleration in deaths. I remind you people that Anything above zero in those two graphs points to acceleration, and anything below zero points to a slowdown. So we had a steep acceleration in deaths on Sunday. Another point to consider is that the Italian government ordered a lockdown of large parts of the north of the country, including the city of Milan. The market reaction, the tumble in equities, the tumble in commodity-linked currencies, and the surge in safe havens suggests that investors are unconvinced that the virus can be contained soon, something that heightened further recession fears. All this adds more credence to our view that eventually the economic woods could well drag into the second quarter of the year, and absent any headlines that a vaccine could be introduced soon, equities and risk-linked assets are likely to continue tumbling as investors seek shelter in safe havens like bonds, the yen, the Swiss franc, and the euro. Following the latest stock market route, U.S. Treasury yields continue to slide, with the 10-year rate hitting a new record low of around 0.48 after closing at 0.77 on Friday. While according to the Fed Funds futures, market participants now expect the FOMC to cut by 75 basis points at its upcoming gathering scheduled for next week. You can see that rates in April are expected to be well below a 50 basis points cut. So it means that next week, market participants expect the FOMC to cut by more than 50 basis points. So expectations are for 55 basis points at the upcoming gathering. So April's rates will be below a 50 basis point cut. Now, as for Tuesday, during the Asian morning, we get Australia's NAB Business Confidence Index for February. Okay, but no forecast is available. Last week, the RBA kickstarted a coordinated effort by major central banks to fight the economic damages of the fast-spreading coronavirus. The bank cut interest rates by 25 basis points to a new record low of 0.5% and remained willing to ease further if needed. In January, the NAB Business Confidence Index stood at minus 1. So bearing in mind that the virus is spreading accelerated in February, we see the case for the index to slid further into the negative territory. This will add more credence to the view that further cuts by the RBA may be needed. Now, according to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rates futures implied yield curve, the chart of which I have here, another quarter point cut is nearly fully priced in for the April meeting. Okay, the RBA cut interest rates at the beginning of March, and now they are expected to cut rates at the beginning of April, again by 25 basis points. Now, from China, we get the CPI and PPI rates for February. The CPI rate is forecast to have declined to 5.2% from 5.4% year over year, while the PPI one is anticipated to have turned back negative. Namely, it is expected to have fallen to minus 0.3% year over year from plus 0.1%. Now, bearing in mind that the restrictive measures adopted by Chinese authorities to fight the coronavirus appear to have hurt the economy, it is more than normal for the CPI and PPI rates to have fallen, perhaps even more than the forecasts suggest. On Saturday, data showed that the nation's trade surplus turned into deficit in February, which combined with a slump in inflation may increase concerns that the virus's economic effects are larger than previously estimated, and thereby prompt investors to reduce further their risk exposure. During the European morning, we get more inflation data for February, this time from Norway. Both the headline and core CPIs are expected to have slowed to 1.4% year over year and 2.3% from 1.8% and 2.9% respectively. Now, the headline rate would be much lower than the Norges Bank latest forecast for the month, which is at 1.9%, but the core one will be much higher than its respective estimate of 1.8%. Now, under normal circumstances, such prints would have been unlikely to alter policymakers' view that interest rates are likely to stay at the present level in the coming period. Nonetheless, with central banks worldwide easing their respective policies in order to prevent a global recession, due to the effects of the coronavirus, Norges Bank officials may decide to leave aside economic data and follow the footsteps of the RBA, the FOMC, and the Bank of Canada. The sharp tumble in oil prices today could also be a reason for lower interest rates. Continuing with Tuesday's data, we also get the final GDP for quarter four for the fourth quarter from Eurozone, which is expected to confirm its second estimate, namely that economic growth in the euro area has slowed to 0.1 from 0.3 in the third quarter. We also get the bloc's employment change for the same quarter, with the forecast suggesting an acceleration to 0.3% from 0.1%. Now, on Wednesday, the main event is likely to be the UK budget. Actually, this is the autumn budget that was scheduled for November 2019, but was delayed due to the fact that general elections were called. Under normal circumstances, this time of the year, we have the spring statement, which is an updated which is an update on the numbers. Now, in any case, this would be the first budget of the new Chancellor Rishi Sunak, who replaced Sajid Javid back on February 13th. Javid's stance over spending was seen as more cautious than Sunak's, and thus it would be interesting to see how expansionary the new budget will be. In the midst of the domestic economic slowdown and fears over the coronavirus impact, decent fiscal support may lessen the need for the Bank of England to proceed with aggressive easing as the FOMC and the Bank of Canada did. So this could prove supportive for the pound. The UK GDP for January, as well as industrial and manufacturing production data for the month, are coming out, but they may get overshadowed by the budget announcement. Just for the record, economic growth is expected to have slowed to 0.2% month over month from 0.3%, while the year-over-year rates of industrial production and manufacturing production are forecast to have slid further into the negative territory. Specifically, they are anticipated to have declined to minus 2.5% and -3.3% from -1.8% and -2.5%. The nation's trade balance is also coming out, and expectations are for December surplus to have turned into a deficit in January. From the US, we get the CPIs for February. The headline rate is expected to have declined to 2.2% from 2.5%, while the core rate is anticipated to have remained unchanged at 2.3%. Now, under normal circumstances, CPI rates above the Fed's 2% inflation aim would have allowed officials to remain sidelined, despite their favorite metric being the core PCE rate, which runs below 2%. Having said that, though, after last Tuesday's double cut, Fed Chair Powell highlighted that the fundamentals of the U.S. economy remain strong, adding that they decided to cut due to the risks the coronavirus poses to economic activity. Thus, we don't expect U.S. economic data to alter expectations around the Fed's future course of action. Now, on Thursday, the spotlight is likely to turn to the ECB monetary policy decision. Market participants are confident that this bank will follow the footsteps of the RBA, the FOMC, and the Bank of Canada in easing policy in order to safeguard the global economy from the effects of the coronavirus. That said, expectations are for just a 10 basis points cut in the deposit rate. Having that in mind, for the euro to give back some of its recent gains, a bolder action is needed, but we see that as unlikely. With the euro area deposit rate already deep in the negative zone, it stands at -0.5%. The ECB has much less room to cut rates compared to other major central banks. This may have been one of the catalysts behind the euro's latest rally. The other one could have been the unwinding of carry trades, as the common currency appears to have been used as a vehicle for such trades. In any case, we believe that the ECB will indeed cut by 10 basis points and repeat that it remains willing to use all its tools if needed, but absent any deeper cut, a strong signal that this could happen at one of the upcoming meetings, we expect the euro to continue outperforming its US counterpart. Even if the ECB decides to use other easing tools besides rate cuts, any such action cannot be compared to the elevated market expectations for a triple cut at next week's FOMC gathering. Now, as for Thursday's economic indicators, during the European morning, Sweden's inflation data are coming out. The headline CPI is forecast to have accelerated to 1.7% year over year from 1.3%, but the CPIF rate is anticipated to have ticked down to 1.1% from 1.2%. We believe that this time around, inflation may not prove so determinant with regards to the Riksbank's policy plans. Since last week, central banks around the globe have been easing policy in a coordinated effort to safeguard economic activity from the effects of the coronavirus. And this means that the world's oldest central bank may not hesitate bringing interest rates back into the negative territory. As for Thursday's other data, we have Eurozone's industrial production for January, the US PPIs for February. The euro area industrial production is expected to have rebounded 1.3% month over month after tumbling 2.1%, which will drive the year over year rate up to minus 3.4% from minus 4.1%. Now, with regards to the US PPIs, the headline rate is anticipated to have declined to 1.8% year over year from 2.1%, while the core one is forecast to have held steady at 1.7%. Now, finally, on Friday, Germany releases its final CPI data for February, but as it is usually the case, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. In the US, the preliminary University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for March is due out, and the forecast points to a decline to 95 from 101 in February. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you again here next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 8:30 o'clock a.m. GMT time. So goodbye from me. Have a nice day and have a great week.
JFT, just fair and direct.